in Indian history, the important phase is there when Islamic invades India. But before discussing this Islamic invasion, we have to discuss a few parts in world history. We'll connect that to Indian history from 700 AD onwards. Now we have discussed that in ancient world, nomadic tribes were there. Civilized part was very, very less. The remaining world that was of nomadic tribes. Like that, so many tribes, they were settled in Arabia, the desert. All of these Arabs were idolaters. The Arabian Peninsula, again we have to go for a map, just try to recollect. We have drawn world map in geography first, in history also when Alexander's invasion was there. Now let us start drawing map again. I will suggest you can draw map with me. Just take pen. Pen means PE and pen. Africa, Madagascar Island, Sinai. Can connect here Sinai. This is Arabian Peninsula. No, no, this is rough map. Try to recollect Black Sea, Grecia or Greece, Italy, Gibraltar, Spain, Black Sea, then Caspian Sea, somewhat map is stretched out. So important things only we have to discuss, that whatever this region, say this is the peninsular region where here Persian Gulf and here Red Sea, that is where the area between Red Sea and Persian Gulf and some of the territories over here, that territory is desert. You are quite aware that this is Sahara Desert, entire Sahara Desert, where Egypt is there, that is the only civilized world in old days. Then this is Arabian Peninsula. Try to recollect, in old days we have discussed about Assur Empire or Ashur Empire, whatever discussed. The Assur Empire was there in somewhere in region of this Iraq, and then onwards they settled down over here in Babylonia portion. So whatever we are talking of Chaldean culture, then Babylonian culture, Assyrian culture, that was there in eastern part of Arabia. Now, as we have discussed, in earlier days, Roman Empire was there. The lot of trade was carried out first with Greek and later on Roman Empire. Maximum Roman Empire trade was carried out here in Shurparaka port, that is modern days Nala Sopara. So from Shurparak to this Roman world, trade was carried out. But later on, because of Hunnic invasion, say Hun were from Mongolia. From Mongolia, they settled to Hungary and then tried to conquer this European world, especially plundered out European world, and therefore the Roman Empire collapsed out. After collapse of Roman Empire, the entire trade between India and Western world, that was controlled by Arab people. So somewhere around 3rd century AD, the incident happened. And till that, after that, the trade was dominated by Arab people. So now Arab traders were visiting India, and the trade was like that from India to Mecca, and then on landline till here, a city that is capital of Eastern Roman Empire, that is Constantinople. So till Constantinople, Arab dominance, and Constantinople onwards in Europe, the trade was carried out by European traders. The another way was there, that through this Red Sea, they were reaching till Alexandria port, and from Alexandria, they were carried out to Rome. So like that, trade was carrying out over there. Now Arab invaders, or say Arab traders, first we have to discuss about traders. So Arab traders, they were engaged in now trading. At the same time, the Arab invaders, they were acting on this sea, Arabian Sea particularly, and they worked as pirates. So because of that, the Arab continent, subcontinent, was becoming richer and richer. No doubt, in old days, the Arabs were ruled by many foreigners. Say for example, the Achaemenid Empire of Persia. That Achaemenid Empire was there on part of Arabia. After that, Greek Empire, the Hellenic world, that was also on part of Arabia, the Greek rule was there. After that, Roman Empire, that was there around Mediterranean Sea. So that was also there. So like that, again, Persian Empire was there. So like that, Arabia was ruled by foreign invaders time to time. Nearly 1,000 years is a span where Arabia was ruled by outsiders. The most important thing, that they were staying as tribes, and they were having deities. Each tribe was having their own deity. The idol was produced. They were gathered at Mecca. Here, the position of Mecca, somewhere here. In few books, the spelling is given as M-E-C-C-A, so Mecca is also pronounced. Now, in this Mecca, there was huge temple that was called as Kaaba. And there, somewhere 350 or plus idols were there. And in particular period, all Arabs were united there for their whatever the rituals are there, sacrifices there. And during that particular period, they were not carrying out war. The non-violence was particularly obeyed in particular that patch. Otherwise, Arabia was in disturbed position. The rules were somewhat strange. Given that polygyny was no doubt popular in old days, but after death of father, son used to marry with father's wives. What we can say about the people, even in our own epics, we are mentioning about Asur, that is the Asur culture that is here only. In Ramayana, if you are reading out, the Ravan was explaining to Vibhishan that to capture other's wife, and that is the Asur culture, that is the tradition of our Asur. So like that, explanations were given. Now debate is there whether they belong to Iraq or originally from Sri Lanka, but whatsoever matter, it is possible that from Iraq they must have captured Sri Lanka. Many people believe that Ravan was not originally born in Iraq or Sri Lanka, he was born in India only. Say whatsoever thing, the racially may be possible. Why we are using word Asur then? And in spite that these people, they were having name, the great empires in old days, around 600 BC or even before that, they were having name as Asur Nisar Pal, Asur Bani Pal. We have adults of that. And that is the evidence that this was having some impact of Asur or some cruel culture that was followed over there. Now, Muhammad Paigambar, the prophet, he established Islam here. Somewhere the birth of Muhammad Paigambar is around 570 AD, and at age of 40 he got first message from Allah. Allah means the greatest, topmost authority, that is called as God. We can translate it. that is the Allah, the only one creator of the world. From that, he received a message with help of Jibrail or Gabriel, or another name is there, that is Ruh ul Qudas. So from that, he received this message, and then onwards, he received set of message again and again. That set of message is collected in form of book that is called as Holy Quran. Now, this incident happened somewhere around 610 AD onwards. So this way, the Islam was established in Makkah. Before that, the important religion in this subcontinent, that was there a Jew religion. In Hindi, we are calling it as Yahudi. So Yahudi or Jew people, they were staying over here, and Jew people, they were dominated in this particular area. In Bible, we get detailed story, because the first part of Bible, that is called as Old Testament, that is nothing but the sacred book of Jew people, that is called as Torah. So in English we are calling as Torah, Arabic we are calling as Taurat. So Taurat is first part of Bible, that is the sacred book of Jewish people, that is called as Old Testament. There it is mentioned everything about the Jew. That actually this is not one should call as only religious book. Rather, we are getting more history and knowledge in those days, what was happened over here. So this is that Jew people, they were forced to leave this Israel. The native of Israel, this portion was Israel in those days. So from Israel, they entered in Egypt and stayed nearly 400 years over there. Then Musa, or in English we are calling as Moses. Moses was able to take back the Jewish people to their homeland again, and Israel was flourished again. Later on, Jesus Christ born in this Israel, and Christianity was established over here. So as we have discussed about religion, the three great religion originated in ancient India. They are Vedicism, Jainism and Buddhism. In Arabia, first the oldest religion, that was Jew. The second religion established, that is Christianity, that is around BC, around AD. And third religion established, that is Muslim or Islam. Now Islam was established by Muhammad Paigambar. Two books we should keep in mind. One is Holy Quran, that is word of Allah, brought to earth by Gabriel, Jibrail or Ruh ul Qudas, accepted by Prophet Muhammad. Second, that is called as Hadith. That Hadith was written by Muhammad Paigambar, the Prophet. Now, after Muhammad Paigambar, the chief of Muslim community, that was considered as Khalifa, Khalif or Khalifa, the first Khalifa, that was Abu Bakr, then Umar, Usman, and Ali. Now, Ali was son-in-law of Muhammad Paigambar. Few people believe that first Khalifa must be Ali. They are called as Shia. And those who believe that first Khalifa must be Abu Bakr, they are called as Sunni. So like that, two sects are there in Islam. Mainly two sects, that is Sunni and Shia. They are based on this fact about the first four Khalifa, who is the first and who is the last, fourth one. Accordingly, later on this Caliphate means the chief of Islam, Islamic world, that was split up, and different parts of world, they declared themselves as Khalifa like that. During Islamic invasion of India, the Caliphate was there in Baghdad, in Syria, Damascus. That was the place of Caliphate. Later on, it was taken by Turkey invaders, and Turkey Empire was considered as Khalifa of the Islamic world in those days. So different dynasties, like kings, different dynasties were ruled on. Now what is the difference between Jesus Christ and Muhammad Paigambar? That Jesus Christ preached about non-violence, whereas Prophet Muhammad accepted violence for protection and spread of Islam. And that's why Islam was spread out in westward direction first, and by conquering Egypt to all this northern territory,
that is Sahara Desert was conquered. Then they entered in this Gibraltar, Arabic world is there, and Gibraltar, and then they invaded this Spain part. The Spain was under rule. At that time, Spain was ruled by Visigoth kingdom. As we have discussed, these tribal people were there in Europe. They were called as Vandal, then Hun, and Visigoth. So third tribe or third nomadic tribe invaded European Empire, Roman Empire, that was Visigoth. So Visigoth destroyed this Western Roman Empire part, and this was under rule of Visigoth kingdom. Then from Visigoth king was defeated by this Arab invader. They were basically called as Moors, the Morocco, the Moor. We can keep in mind the hybrid of Arab and Moroccan people. And Arab was under rule of Moor, or Spain was under rule of Moor or Arab people. Then the famous Battle of Tours. The French pronunciations are difficult. So battle at Tours, there the Arabs were defeated. On first days it was neutral, but second day Arabs were defeated, and then onwards this boundary was maintained. So this was part of Arabic Empire. Then here entire Iraq and Iran, during that period Iran was under Zoroastrian rule. Ardeshir is the name of empire. Now Ardeshir fought with Arab people. He defeated many times, but Arab invaders were coming again and again, and continuous attack weakened out the part of Iraq, and ultimately Iraq falls under rule of Arab. Later on, entire Iran was conquered by Arab, and this way the Arabian Empire was spread from Iran to Spain. And obviously now we have to turn to India, that these great personalities from Arabia, now they are ready, they were ready to enter in India. Now different stories are given. According to one story, two naval battles were fought at this particular portion, the Thana district of Maharashtra, near that, and at that time Chalukya rule was there. And first Arabic invasion that was completely uprooted in the sea, the Arabs were simply killed, destroyed in Arabian Sea. The second invasion was carried out at Bharuch, somewhere north to Nalasopara, that was also completely uprooted. Only 100 Arabs were able to return to Arabia. If you want to read out, one book is there written by Purushottam Nagesh Oak. So in that book these explanations are given. Now then, the third Arabic invasion was carried out here. The port is there in Sindh. This is called as Deval. So in Deval port, the Arab ruler, at that time Arab invader named Muhammad bin Qasim, he was relative of Khalifa of Syria. The Damascus was capital, and the first Arabic, successful Arabic invasion was carried out by Muhammad bin Qasim, somewhere 16 or 17 year old. And for that, tremendous army was required. For that, money, obviously. The Arab traders supported this huge army. Muhammad bin Qasim promised them that after conquering the India, whatever money they will plunder out, whatever you are investing, four times that you will get return. And on basis of that, some 50,000 Arabic invaders, they entered at Deval port, that is there in Sindh territory. The ruler was Dahir. He was Brahmin ruler, as described by foreigners. And he was troubling out Buddhist people over there. So Buddhist people betrayed, and they showed the path for Muhammad bin Qasim, as it is given. The reason was very simple given, that why Muhammad bin Qasim entered in India. The reason they are giving, that one Arab trader was died in somewhere Sri Lanka. His two wives were there. So King of Sri Lanka sent them back to Arabia. And while going over here, say traveling like this. So in the region of Sindh, pirates attacked their ship. Then Khalifa asked this Dahir to control the piracy, whereas Dahir argued something, and then attack was carried out. Ultimately, the battle was fought between Dahir and Muhammad bin Qasim. The first battle of Panipat, second battle of Panipat, or whatever the battles, many times history repeats like this way, that Dahir was there on elephant. Elephant was injured. Actually, Dahir was going to win, but surprisingly, elephant was injured, and then Dahir was defeated, killed, and then this entire region of India, especially Sindh territory till Multan, was captured by Muhammad bin Qasim. For four subsequent years, Muhammad bin Qasim was carrying out destruction over here, as we are saying, whereas according to certain foreign websites, they are saying he was establishing law and order over his territory. He was tolerant to all religions, and even Buddhism was flourished under his rule. Say, what is our first argument? As we have discussed, the loss of Buddhism, it is clearly mentioned in history that this territory was having Buddhist population, and later on, during Arab rule, this population, whatever the people were there, they converted to Islam, because they were not able to fight. Simple thing, that how we can fight with non-violence. And therefore, the Vedic people, they were not able to convert easily. I'm not saying not at all converted. They are not converted easily, but Buddhist converted easily. For more detail, you can refer out that book, Six Glorious Epoch. There you will find the details of this invasion. After 4 years, Muhammad bin Qasim was betrayed and killed. Then onwards, Arab invaders stops their propagation. Later on, Arabs realized, according to R.C. Muzumdar's book, Arab realized that Indian culture is superior than Arab culture. And slowly and steadily, they get absorbed in Indian society. But the religion, as we have discussed, that Menander accepted Buddhism, the Kanishka accepted Buddhism, like that, these Arabs were not accepted Buddhism. They stayed over there as Islamic ruler. They accepted to some extent Indian culture, but they get mixed over here, and later on, no further invasion was carried out by Arab. So this is the glory of Arab Empire that was there around 7th, 8th, 9th century AD. That entire this part. So in this particular period, what Arabs carried out? The learned Arab, they studied out Indian text. Whatever the books are there, and these books are translated to Arabian language. And later on, from Arabia, these books were translated to European languages. Arabs established two great universities. They were fond of study. And like Takshashila and Nalanda, they were inspired from that. And they established this university. Out of that, one university was there in Spain. That was Cordova University. And even Pope used to study in this university. So the knowledge was there with Arab now. Why? Because they got the part of India. And from India, they translated many books. Obviously, that latter invasion destroyed these books. And so we lost our knowledge. But that knowledge was properly taken from India to Europe. Say for example, as we have discussed, the numerical system. Till that, the world was lacking in numerical system. But Indian numerical system was great, is great rather, because whatever numerical system we are following, that is Indian numerical system. Let us check out how you can write the number as 10. According to Roman, you have to write that some symbol 10. Whenever you are carrying out multiplication or addition with these types of number, it is not easy for them. Suppose I am saying write down number which will consist of, say for example, 1 crore.
You have to write in Roman script, write down number 1 crore. Very difficult. According to Greek script, try to write down 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. In this type of sequence, you have to write down number 1 crore. Very difficult. But according to Indian system, it's very easy. You can write this way, 1 crore. Say, here 1000, here lakh, here crore. Count out 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So it is simply, I can write as 10 raised to 7. That means 7 zeros on 1. So like that, I can write down number as 10 raised to 100. That means 100 zeros on 1. So this system was well advanced. We were well developed. We had discussed around Gupta rule. During Gupta rule, our great Indian ruler, astronomer, as we had discussed about Varahamihir, Bhaskaracharya, Aryabhatta. So like that, these were able to develop this type of system. Numerical systems were developed in India from old period. Now Arabs just taken out this numerical system from India to Arabic world. And therefore they are calling these names, these numbers as Hindasa. And later on this Hindasa was given to European world. And then Roman numbers were replaced by Indian numbers. So what is the gift of Arab Empire? That simply they transported Indian knowledge to Europe in old times. When Europe was in dark ages, in these dark ages they got light from Arabia, and obviously Arabs were enlightened by India. So this is the fact. Now second Islamic attack was there in India at time of Muhammad Ghaznavi during 1001, this attack was carried out. He was there from Afghanistan. But basically, the question is that in this particular period, why Arabs were remained silent? They were not carried out further attacks in India. Actually, we can observe they were expansionist. Here also they were expansionist towards East. Then some around 720 AD, the Arab attack, that Muhammad bin Qasim attack was there. After that, till 1001, why further attack was not there in India? The reasons we have to discuss. Number one, at that time, Gurjar Pratihar dynasty, as we have discussed, the Pratihara is name, Gurjar is name of clan that was established over here. This is the origin somewhere of Rajput people. The exact origin of Rajput people is not there, clear in history. But certain evidences we can go. Say for example, there is mountain named Abu Mountain. On that, one huge sacrifice was carried out and new Kshatriyas were produced. This type of details are given in certain Puran. We can connect that certain foreigners must have converted to Hinduism in old days and they accepted the Kshatriya clan. So this way new Kshatriya were produced and they were probably Rajputs. So from this part, the Rajput attack or Rajput were there, may be possible their natives, their ancestors, maybe Gurjar, maybe Hun. But now they were considered as Hindu. The Indianized only. And these Rajputs were able to resist these Arabs properly. At that time, the Rashtrakuta dynasty, we have to discuss yet, but that Rashtrakuta dynasty was there in Maharashtra. The Rashtrakuts were able to build up strong confederation of the kings at northwest part, and therefore these Arabs were not able to invade further. Later on, the Rashtrakuts get banished. Again, it was under rule of Chalukya. And then, the continuous attacks of Rajput, they were aggressive. Even Bappa Rawal, his name of Rajput Empire, who conquered Karachi once again. This way, the Arabs were not remained silent, but they were checked out continuously from remaining part of India by making this type of confederations. Then onwards,
they get absorbed here, Indianized to some extent. Then the rest of the part of world, this nomadic world was there. So continuous attacks were carried out here, sometime nomadic world and sometime by Islamic world, and ultimately certain tribes over here, particularly this region that is called as Turkestan. So these Turki people, they were converted to Islam. Then they carried out attack on Afghanistan region, but they were unsuccessful. Now Arabs and Turki combinedly carried out attack over Afghanistan, and tremendous war was there. Arabs and Turki people were successfully able to conquer Afghanistan part. At that time they slaughtered many people, so whether Vedic or Buddhist. According to Arab, they were Hindus, and therefore they are calling the mountain over there as Hindu Kush. The meaning is that tomb of Hindus. So this is the tremendous slaughter where they are in Afghanistan, that is of Hindu people. Because I was having continuous doubt that why Hindu Kush mountain is there in Afghanistan. The reason is that the meaning of that is tomb of Hindu, and therefore that mountain is still survived. Original name, try to recollect, we have discussed, that is Pariyatra Parvat. Now, then onwards, the Turki invader, he carried out attack on India. The Anandpal was ruler of Punjab, but he was not Indian ruler. He was also Turki ruler. He was Hindu, but Turki Hindu. So it was termed as Hindu Shahi dynasty. So Anandpal was ruling during time of Muhammad Ghaznavi. Actually, one war was fought in Afghanistan to check Sabuktagin. But unfortunately, the confederation of Anandpal was lost over there. The battle, again same thing. Initially Anandpal was in winning position, later on he was defeated. After getting success, he was defeated. Then Muhammad Ghaznavi was engaged in war with Central Asia. But he decided, let us stop that war and declare war against idolater. That is the land of idolater, that means India. And he carried out attack on India. The first attack was there, but the first attack was successfully defeated by Anandpal. Muhammad Ghaznavi was set back. But they are not writing that we were defeated. They are saying just we entered in India just to observe what is the climate, in what way people are fighting, etc. They are writing out. But in second attack, Anandpal was defeated. In third attack, Anandpal was defeated again, and ultimately he committed suicide. The Jaipal was the ruler of now this part. Then onwards, total 17 invasions were carried out by Muhammad Ghaznavi. The plunder of Somnath, say this is Afghanistan, where here is a Somnath. So plunder of Somnath, Kanauj, like that 17 raids were carried out by Muhammad Ghaznavi, and ultimately he died at Ghazni. At death of Muhammad Ghaznavi, Ghazni was said to be richest and the most beautiful city in the world. Tremendous wealth was accumulated from India by this Muhammad Ghaznavi. In that plunder of Somnath was there, somewhere 1700 donkeys were used to take away the wealth only in form of jewels from Somnath to Ghazni. So different numbers are given over there. Ultimately, after death of Muhammad Ghaznavi, there was again quarrel of throne, and just after 50 years of death of Muhammad Ghaznavi, Ghazni was simply burnt out. The richest city was converted into richest coal mine, what we can say about that. But after Muhammad Ghaznavi till 1190, no attack was from northwest part or Afghanistan over here. Again, a peaceful period was there for nearly 200 years.
This is the period of total 500 years. The Islam was established, Islam was spread out. During this period, Iran was completely Islamized. The people, they were not willing to accept Islam, were either killed or they came to India as refugee. These people are called as Zoroastrians or Parsi people. You can find out that the most minority people in India, they are not Muslims, not Christians, not Buddhists, they are Parsi or Zoroastrian people. So this was there from Iran. Especially nowadays research is going on that they were not basically from Iran, but they were from Turkmenistan. So different here, but it is believed that they came by sea route. They come over here on border of Maharashtra and Gujarat. The island is there that is called as Sanjan. And from that, they entered in Gujarat. They stayed over here and completely dissolved and obviously digested in India. So they engaged themselves in trading and development of India. The most important Parsi people, say, number wise they are very less, but quality wise they are very superior. We can check out certain Parsi people, famous, world famous Parsi people, that is the Tata. I should not speak further. Then our BARC, whatever we are calling, that is Homi Jahangir Bhabha. Then Godrej, like that, scientists, companies, and what is the most important thing, that Firoz Gandhi, and so on. So these Parsi people completely dissolved. The example is given, as sugar is added in milk, they dissolved in Indian community. Now question here is very simple, that why the Arabs, they were successful everywhere in the world, but they were not able to establish their empire in entire India. Only northwest, certain part of western India till Sindh territory and some parts of Punjab, they were able to establish, but why not entire India? Then for nearly 300 years, no attack was carried out again. And after 300 years, the Muhammad Ghaznavi, he was not able to establish his rule successfully over India. He was just carried out raids. He was not carried out the empire building like Muhammad Ghauri. For nearly 500 years after the establishment of Islam, the India was safe from foreign attack. And somewhere around in 1190 onwards, the Muhammad Ghauri, he was also Turk, but he settled in Afghanistan. So he carried out the further invasion after getting defeats. And so many times he was defeated. Even he was defeated by King of Gujarat. He was defeated by Queen of Gujarat. He was defeated by Prithviraj Chauhan. But ultimately, in one battle, he was successful, where Prithviraj Chauhan was imprisoned. And that is called as Battle of Tarayan. So in that Battle of Tarayan, Tarayan is near Panipat. So always keep in mind, this Panipat position is very important for Delhi. So Battle of Tarayan, he was defeated ultimately. He was able to defeat ultimately Prithviraj Chauhan, and he conquered Delhi. The original name was Dillika. Then the Delhi was conquered by this Muhammad Ghauri. He appointed his governor over there. During that period, slavery was more common, and he appointed his one of the slave, the most liable slave, he appointed there, that was Qutubuddin Aibak. Under his leadership, the Turki Empire in India developed. So till here, Muhammad Ghauri was successful to establish the Turki rule in India. But later on, the further expansion was carried out by Qutubuddin Aibak. Then Bakhtiar Khilji was another slave. So Bakhtiar Khilji was penetrated entire UP, Bihar, Bengal and Assam region. In Assam, in those days, one tribe was ruling that was called as Ahom. So Ahom tribe, they defeated Bakhtiar Khilji over there. But in his attack, he destroyed India's another famous university, that was Nalanda University. So keep in mind, two world famous universities in India. First one was Takshashila, that was destroyed in Hun attack. Whereas second famous university, that was Nalanda, that was destroyed in Bakhtiar Khilji's attack. And we are asking question that Indians were not keeping any proof. Indians were not having habit of writing anything. Keep in mind, when Nalanda University was destroyed, whatever the books, sacred books were there in that university, keep in mind at that time printing press was not there. The handwritten books were there. That fire was there for nearly 10 days. The 10 days books were burning out. See the quantity of books, and we have only ash and remains of this Nalanda University now. So this is the reason that, like that, say, what is recorded in history, that I am telling. So what is not recorded, that is another thing. And so many books are simply burnt away. The few books we are keeping purposefully in secret way, the secrecy starts here. So henceforth, we are discussing out Slave Dynasty or establishment of Turki rule over India. After death of Emperor Prithviraj Chauhan and after succession of throne by Muhammad Gauri expanded empire in northern parts of India. No doubt, again and again, they are calling as Hindustan, that means India. But practically speaking, initially they were not having hold on entire India. Only few territories were under rule of this Turk dynasty. For example, as we have discussed, this part, the northwest part of India, that was there under their rule. Then Rajputana was not part of their rule. Then UP until Assam, this all territory that was under their rule. So directly speaking, entire India, because many times in history we find these things. For example, in Battle of Tarai, Prithviraj Chauhan get defeated and India becomes slave of these people. But no, practically speaking, part of northern India, not entire northern India, a part of northern India that was there under Turki rule. Now, first ruler of this Turki dynasty, it was Slave Dynasty we are calling. In old days, as we have discussed, they were using slaves, and slavery was very much common. And the slave means that only hardworking men, talented people, they were also hunted, that means searched out properly and given opportunity to learn. And then these people were having certain rights also. Say for example, Qutubuddin Aibak, a slave of Muhammad Gauri, he was having right to rule on India. Then Bakhtiar Khilji, in India only, but he was chief of Bengal territory. Kubecha, he was also having certain province, Uch. So, and Yaldoz, he was having territory of Afghanistan, Ghazni. All these four persons, they were slave of Muhammad Gauri. So, these type of opportunities were there. So, we have to think that the northern part of India became slave of this Slave Dynasty. Just think of this, that originally Turki ruler Muhammad Gauri, his slave Qutubuddin Aibak, he was appointed as governor over there. And the people living under slave, so what we can call that part, slave of slave, what else we can call? Now henceforth we have to discuss the history of Delhi Sultanate. one can properly say Delhi Sultanate. But keep in mind, Delhi was not capital of India in that days. So it is not necessary that Delhi Sultanate means all over India rule. So please keep in mind henceforth that whenever we are discussing this Delhi Sultanate, certain problems on northern India, they were there. Now at that time, South India was enjoying entire freedom. Even Deccan, that was also having entire freedom. Rajputana, parts of Madhya Pradesh, Malwa, Gujarat, they were enjoying freedom. But the certain parts, say for example, Punjab, Sindh, then parts of Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, Bengal, and parts of Assam, because in Assam, Bakhtiar Khilji was defeated. So, this part were under this slave dynasty. And again, there was terrific struggle for the Delhi Sultanate. So, Sultan, that means the ruler over here. So, Sultanate, the word coming out from that means kingdom. So, henceforth, we are using word Sultanate instead of this kingdom, because this Sultan rule, this period is of Sultan period. Now, certain discussion we have to carry out here. The reason is that views must be clear henceforth. So, in old days, India was not united. Again and again, we are calling that India was not united. The meaning is that several states were there. As we have discussed in Gupta Empire, the direct rule of Gupta that was there on parts of Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, today Jharkhand also, then Bengal. Otherwise, the feudals or tributaries, they were ruling through tributaries. So that mechanism still worked in India. For example, in rule, under rule of this slave dynasty, the territories, they were not 100% occupied by this slave dynasty. Many territories were giving tribute and enjoying self-government. So like that, things were continuously going on. So don't think that entire India was under Turki rule. Many times historians explain the Muslim rule. Say their religion was Muslim. But Muslim rule, one should say different. And Turki rule, here actually one can, the invader can be differentiated by religion also now and by their origin. Say for example, first Islamic attack was carried out by Arabs. Now at the end of 9th century, they returned back to Arabia. So Islamic attack, but the attackers, they were Arabs. Second attack, Turk, that is Muhammad Ghaznavi. No doubt, he was having name as Ghaznavi. Ghazni belonged to Afghanistan and not to Turkestan. He was born at Nishapur. Nowadays it is in Iran, but in old days it was part of Turkestan. So Nishapur, as name indicate, I should not talk much of that. So he was born at Nishapur and ruled over Ghazni. So instead of calling Muhammad of Nishapur, we are calling Muhammad of Ghazni, and he was Turki. Then next, that Muhammad Ghori, he was also Turki, but settled at Afghanistan. So more properly, we can call them as Turko-Afghan. But in history, we are calling them as Turki. So Qutubuddin Aybak, or this Turki rule that was established in northern parts of India. Then we have to discuss again that Mongol people. The thing, Mongols, they are invading India again and again. In old part of history, say for example, as we have discussed about Huns, because of these Mongols or Huns, so many troubles we had to face. Say for example, attack of Scythian people, attack of Kushan, then ultimately first attack of Hun, second attack of Hun, like that. But after that second attack of Hun, the Huns get settled in India. They were accepted Hinduism and they get settled in northern west, northwest part of India. Later on, the Mongols attack were not there on part of world for few years, few centuries. But under emperorship of Genghis Khan, they again united.
and they started their rides all over the world as Huns were carried out. The Huns were ideal people for them, and they also carried out same thing as Huns were. Chengiz Khan, as name indicates, he was not a Muslim. Keep in mind, Muslim culture is different.
Whereas the words they are using, they are different. For example, as we have discussed, they are having terrific influence of Persian language. Because just observe, here is the Persia, and Arabia was having terrific influence of Persia time to time. The Khan, that means ruler, say we can say with respect to India, governor, the governor of large territory, that can be entitled as Khan. So Chengiz Khan, that means something world ruler, like that word is there. Name indicate Khan, that means he should not considered as Muslim. Targi is the name of his religion. So he belonged to that Targi religion from Mongolia. He was very cruel. Terrific destruction was carried out by them. And fortunately, Chengiz Khan was not able to enter in India. But he destroyed several parts of the world. And therefore, he is famous in world history. And today also, in Mongolia, he is worshipped. The statues of Chengiz Khan are erected. In parliament also, we have statue of Mongolia, that Chengiz Khan, of course, parliament of Mongolia. There they are admiring Chengiz Khan because world conqueror. Anyway, but followed by Chengiz Khan, Mongol rites were prominent. The initially Mongols were non-Muslims, but later on they get converted to Islam and they invaded India. So first, whenever they were non-Muslims, we are calling them as Mongol, and after acceptance of Islam, we are calling them as Mughal. So this is the thing. So henceforth, we should not call this as Islamic attack or Muslim rule. Instead of that, we have to specify the origin. So here, the Slave dynasty, that is Turki dynasty or Turki rule. So we are calling that part as Turki rule. Now in Turki rule, the prominent things. Number one, that in the court, religious tolerance was not observed. Only Muslims were there in the court, nobles, generals, whatever. They were Muslims, and Indian Muslims were not having that much importance. Only Turki or Afghan, they were having importance. So practically speaking, this was foreign rule on parts of India. Qutubuddin Aybak ruled nearly for 4 years, from 1206 to 1210. The Qutub Minar, which is famous, that is the perpetual monument of this Qutubuddin Aybak, as written in the history. Same way, some mosque is there in the name of Qutub. So that is also in the name of Qutub. It is given over and it is written in history that Qutub Minar was erected by Qutubuddin Aybak. Now Qutubuddin Aybak was an efficient ruler. He expanded the Islamic or Turki rule over northern parts of India. After Qutubuddin Aybak, his son was succeeded, but he ruled nearly 1 year and he was replaced by another slave. The Aram Baksh was son of Qutubuddin Aybak. He was deposed by another slave of Muhammad Ghauri and son-in-law of Qutubuddin Aybak named Iltamash. So here we can go by the slave dynasty. Just check out, first one was Qutubuddin Aybak. He ruled from 1206 to 1210. The second one, Aram Baksh, from 1210 to 11. So just after successing he was deposed immediately, and that was by Shamsuddin, Iltamash or Altamash. Many times the spellings given in the English, they are having some variation. Now whatever the pronunciation I am giving to the thing, but actually I am also not aware of which is the correct pronunciation, because some words are pronounced in different way in different language. So I am not aware of these Turkish or Arabic Persian pronunciations. So Shamsuddin, now here din, that is the religion. Ud means of, so something of religion. So like that the names are there. So 1211 to 1236, that was the ruling period of Iltutmish. He was the successful Turki ruler because he expanded the empire. He conquered different Hindu states in Bengal as well as Ranthambore, that means Rajputana part. He completed the construction of Qutub Minar. So no doubt, as we are saying, Qutub Minar was erected by, so erected by Qutubuddin Ayubak, but completed by this Iltutmish. Now during rule of Qutubuddin, as we have discussed, that Mongols were troubling out the world under leadership of Chengiz Khan. Now they are here from map, you can say this is India, then there is a China portion, and here somewhere this is the region, or if this is as we have discussed, this is elongated some here, the period portion of Mongolia. This Chengiz Khan, he followed this way, then he carried out attack over here till Arabia. Even it is given in some book that he visited Makkah also, then from Syria somewhere to Moscow and returned back. So this is the Mongol invasion period. Now in Afghanistan, this portion, at that time Afghanistan was under rule of Jalaluddin. Jalaluddin asked help of Iltutmish against observing the fact that Iltutmish was refused to help because Chengiz Khan and his army was more dominating. The vigor and he felt that this Chengiz Khan is no doubt invincible, and therefore he refused Jalaluddin to help. Chengiz Khan appreciated Iltutmish for his wiseness, but according to historians, he saved his kingdom. Otherwise, may be possible the Mughal attack was there under rule of Chengiz Khan on India. So he saved India from this Chengiz Khan's attack. Like that things are given, in some books it is given that Chengiz Khan entered in India, parts of India, but in wrong season, in summer, and therefore he returned back. So nature defeated Chengiz Khan. And here it is mentioned that because Iltutmish, he not helped Jalaluddin, and therefore Chengiz Khan was returned back. Anyway, so whatever the thing, in those days the Mongol invasion started again after immediate. Iltutmish introduced silver coin named Tanka and copper coin named Jital. On coin he declared himself as lieutenant of Khalifa. See, in this particular period, why we are calling this Islamic period, the reason is that ruler was having this tendency that he must be recognized by Khalifa, and he was ruling over India on behalf of Khalifa. So every invader was trying to take recognition from Khalifa. No doubt no single Khalifa was there, but still they were pleased by when they were recognized by Khalifa. Now this is about rule of Iltutmish. Actually details are there, but we have to complete our syllabus. Therefore, we have to take a brief account of each and every ruler. Say, after Shamsuddin Iltutmish, his son Ruknuddin was on rule, but he was only having short rule of 1936 only, replaced by the daughter of Iltutmish, that is Razia Sultana, the first female ruler under Islamic rule of India. So she was capable, and according to Iltutmish, she was capable, therefore she should be appointed as ruler, Sultana. So this is the rule of Razia Sultana. But the Turki nobles were not able to accept the fact that one lady is ruling over them. Again, she was in love of one Abyssinian slave. This is the Egypt part. This portion is somewhere, that is Somalia, Ethiopia. This part of Ethiopia that was called as, in old days, that was part is called as Habsan. H-B-S-A-N. In English, we are calling as Abyssinia. So, Abyssinian slave, that is dark skin slave, was there. Turki daughter in love of dark skin, or say this Abyssinian slave, was not tolerated in those days, and ultimately she was deposed. So till here, total set of 40 council members become dominant. They were called as Turkani Chahalgani or Chalisa. Chalisa means 40. So this 40 council members become dominant, and with help of them, this next ruler, that Bahram Shah, he was brother of Razia, he captured the throne. No doubt that Razia was in love of Yakut. After that person named Altunia, he ruled a while, but after that she was deposed completely by Bahram Shah, and she was killed while capturing the Delhi once again from Bahram Shah. So here Shamsuddin Iltutmish first son Ruknuddin, second daughter Razia, and third Bahram Shah. See the period from 1236 to 1239-40. The incident took place, and Bahram Shah was ultimately become ruler of this Delhi. Now see, whenever we are calling this Turki rule, they were engaged in fighting with themselves only. So just here we have observed that after Shamsuddin Iltutmish, say here Qutubuddin Aybak was able to rule just for 4 years. After that, Aram Baksh only for 1 year. Then there was struggle between, this was son of Qutubuddin, whereas Shamsuddin Iltutmish was son-in-law of Qutubuddin. Again, Ruknuddin was able to rule for only 1 year, or even less than 1 year. She was deposed by her own sister Razia, and Razia was deposed and killed by her own brother Bahram Shah. Now Bahram Shah was having problem, that Bahram Shah was not actual ruler. The power was there in this Turkani Chahalgani, that means 40 slaves, or say 40, actually they were slaves, but they were now become master. So actual power was in hands of these 40 people, the council member, one can say. And the practical rulers were these 40, whereas Bahram Shah was just like we can say powerless king, that he was presented as emperor, the son of Iltutmish, third son of Iltutmish, but the actual rulers were these 40, and there was constant struggle And in order to attempt to acquire supremacy over these 14, Bahram Shah was deposed. Then the son of Rukruddin, I will show here the connection, the son of Rukruddin, that is Masood Shah, he was appointed as ruler of Delhi.